Ferrell, Pennsylvania. A community where the youth have potential, talent, and promise. A place of extreme hardship, trauma, and crisis. Life isn't easy in the city. The community is battling the opioid crisis, suicide, and violence. A myriad of other rising issues pose a threat to the area. Here, the Community Arts Experience has launched its Arts in Motion program, a program dedicated to providing the youth an opportunity to embrace the arts, develop character, build confidence, and to plant the seeds to help fight back against the threats plaguing the community. Here, we explore how CAE and the Arts in Motion program are building a better tomorrow in the city of Ferrell. City located in Mercer County, Pennsylvania. The mill, which eventually became known as the Romer Works of Sharon Steel Corporation, would serve as the community's lifeblood until 1992, when it was liquidated after filing bankruptcy. Many of the assets were sold at auction to the Britain-based Capero Corporation, and later to Swiss steelmaker DeFuerco, which operates the plant today. In 1912, the population reached 10,000. At that time, the residents of the new city elected to take the name of Ferrell after industrialist James A. Ferrell. The community was incorporated as the borough of South Sharon in 1916. Its population peaked at over 15,000 in 1920, and its status was elevated to a third-class city in 1932. The Community Arts Experience has partnered with several community organizations with the goal of healing, helping, and educating the community. And it is in this very city that we will meet CAE's partners, get to know their backgrounds, expertise, and how they're contributing to uplifting the city of Ferrell.
My name is Michaelene Gula. I am the Executive Director of the Buhl Regional Health Foundation. Buhl Regional Health Foundation is a health conversion foundation that was formed following the sale of Sharon Regional Health System to Community Health Systems of Tennessee. It was sold in 2014, and we are a member of the Health Collaborative, Pennsylvania Health Funders Collaborative. There are over 40 hospitals that have been sold over the past 4 or 5 years, and some even longer, in the state of Pennsylvania that became health conversion foundations. What a health conversion foundation is an organization that is a nonprofit, grant-making organization that provides funds to community agencies and partners to improve the health and well-being of the communities that they serve. Our mission is to improve and address healthcare needs in the community, improve access to care, and to provide and encourage well-being in the community. Christian H. Buhl was the father of Frank Buhl. Christian H. Buhl was an industrialist in probably the mid-1800s. His son, Frank Buhl, actually lived here in the Shenango Valley. Frank Buhl was connected to Andrew Carnegie, Mr. Frick, during the time of the late, following the Civil War, during the late 1800s. They were industrialists. They were at the beginning of the steel industry. So Frank Buhl had property, had a livelihood here, and he had what was the beginning of what was called the share in steel in the Shenango Valley. And he had a connection with the steelmakers in the Pittsburgh area. Now, what he also did in this area is provide a lot of jobs and help people at that time. But he also had a park, which actually was a farm, which became Buhl Park. And one of the things that he knew or he understood about having, even that at that time, the need for a healthy workforce. In 1896, we had a lot of laborers, a lot of people who came from Eastern Europe, who came from other parts of the world, to come here to the United States to live and to make a living, to make a new life. And with that came opportunity to work in the steel mill. My own family, my grandparents, immigrated here from Eastern Europe. Couldn't speak English. They had to have a sponsor who would help them come to the new community. And they also, a lot of times the women did housework for others, maybe some even for people like Mr. Buhl. And the men either worked in coal mines or worked in the early days of the steel industry. With those early days of the steel industry, there were a lot of accidents. There were a lot of things that happened because it was a growing, developing industry, certainly not automated as we know it today, and there were a lot of injuries. Also, this area, because we lacked antibiotics at the time, there were many people who, their young children died of typhoid, various types of illnesses that now we don't even think about now because we have vaccinations. So, Frank Buhl knew that to have a successful steel business, he had to have a healthy community. So in 1896, he and a group of three or four doctors, two or three of them actually were Civil War physicians, decided they were going to build a hospital. They did build an 18-bed hospital on East State Street in Sharon. This hospital was funded by not only Frank Buhl himself and some of the industrialists. There was a Peter Kimberly who was also, at the time, was a very rich man in our community. There were some doctors who also provided funds. But they created an 18-bed hospital. The nurses actually lived at the hospital. They had a garden in the back of the hospital to feed the patients. And they took care of a lot of people who had heavy industrial accidents and tried to care for them as best they could with what they had at the time. Even the workers who in the mill, they even contributed to that. Some gave maybe only what today would be worth 25 cents, but in 1890s, early 1900s, 25 cents was a little bit more than it is today. So that's how the hospital got started. Over the years, the hospital evolved into a 240-bed hospital. We have a psychiatric unit. We have maternity services. Again, a lot of women lost babies during childbirth at that time due to infection and problems. So we had, and the midwives did the best they could, but the hospital eventually provided maternity services, women's care, but that was until the late 1930s. Surgical suite. We started with doctors who were surgeons, but at the time, you know, it was the best they could provide, but over time we know that that has evolved. So the hospital has expanded quite a bit and has served the community for well over 100 years, well, probably closer to 120 years. The fact that after the steel industry started, you know, there was a period of time that, well, actually the Great Depression, if you want to talk about that, in the 1929, that had a great impact. Again, there was poverty. There was a lack of equipment, lack of things that caused health, the health crisis that weren't even invented yet. But over time, through evolution, through modernization of healthcare, we began to improve some of those things. But there are still a lot of things that are related to what are called the social determinants of health. That even though a hospital can care for you, there are things that happen outside of the walls of the hospital that impact health. Okay, such things as what you eat. Okay, do you have healthy food? In the past, because of the ethnic background of the Shenango Valley and the community, many people, if you walked up and down the alleys between these streets here, they all had gardens in the summer. Everybody was growing their tomatoes, their hot peppers, garlic, you know, parsley, you name it, but they grew their own food. They we didn't have as much super processed food. You had real food, basic, healthy food. So lack of food, inadequate food, or food that is super processed, high carbohydrates, things that are not good for you. Okay, if we look at issues related to transportation, that impacts health. Okay, can I get there? Do I have to walk? Can I walk? Years ago, you could ride a bus for 10 cents between Sharon and Farrell. There were more buses. There were trolleys in town. Over time, we've evolved. People drive their own cars, but there are still pockets in the neighborhood. People can't get a ride. They have to depend on somebody. And even the person they depend on or who's willing to give them a ride still wants $5 or a dollar to get them to take them to the grocery store. The grocery stores, you again, back to food, you have limited grocery stores that are actually providing food that is healthy. So again, can I walk? Can I carry it? What can I do? We also look at things related to mental health. You know, as we talk about the adverse childhood events, as we talk about traumatic life experiences, when the father of the home, or the main breadwinner, could be the mother too, loses a job, that impacts, you know, what can I purchase, what can I eat, what am I going to do? It causes tension in the home. There is a situation where children get caught up in this. They observe their parents fighting. They may observe violence. They may observe, you know, trauma experience with their mother and their father. They themselves may be abused. They themselves may be a victim of somebody hitting them and those types of things. Feeling neglected. If we don't have food on the table, we're not going to sit down and say, oh, honey, let's read a story tonight before we go to bed. That doesn't happen. You don't have time to do that. You have kids that are on their own, trying to figure out what's going on. In our communities, we have over 900 children on backpack programs. That means they don't have any food on the weekend. And they're going to after-school programs so they get a third meal that day. And there are a number of those programs that are going on in our community to try to fill that gap. Even though, you know, the steel industry closed 30 years ago, we still have people who are struggling to have their needs met. These things that can happen are called adverse childhood events, and they do have some long-term impact. There have been studies now that are coming out, they're relating them to diabetes development and cardiac disease. Living with chronic stress is not good for your health. It is not. Then we have the exposure to opioids. Okay, yes, in the past, did people who came here from Europe, did they know how to make wine? Did they know how to make whiskey out of potatoes or whatever they were going to do? It's always been here. There's always been an opportunity for people to try to, okay, let's kind of escape a little bit from our reality. But unfortunately, in our area, we have an opioid epidemic, as we do in many rural areas, similar to in Ohio and in West Virginia. These areas. Recently, there was a great amount of news about the lawsuit in Oklahoma and the monies that were received as a result of that lawsuit. But you still have people today who are struggling. We have Mercer County was sixth in the state on babies exposed to opioids during pregnancy. Sixth. So again, struggling parents, not sure that they can parent. They're struggling with raising their children. The children, again, you have to, and then over time, it takes a long time to overcome some of those traumatic experiences. It's important to have these types of programs for young children, for young women. Again, it's exercise, it gets them moving, it helps their self-esteem to be able to see I'm doing something, I'm part of a group, I'm not isolated. There's a lot of things coming out about isolation and not having that connectedness to the community. The connection is very important. When they're doing something, every parent, no matter where their child is, if their child is performing something, you will see by looking at those parents how proud they are of their children. Even if the parents are poor, even maybe more so. That is my baby, that is my child, and I want to see improvement. I want to see them be happy. Every parent wants that. I think building resiliency comes from the importance of letting children know that they have value. You're important. You can achieve something, but you've got to have support. So again, we could, in this program, certain things can be done, but eventually, at the end of the day or the end of the evening, that child still goes home. So again, that parent needs as much support sometimes as that child to keep this going. You need a safety net. You know, within Mercer County, we have family centers, we have after-school programs, we have our Mercer County Behavioral Health program, we have the PACE study where kids actually talk to us about some of the things that they're going through. And so those are things that we need to, again, continue to support parents. It's the child is not being raised in isolation, but the parents need support so that they can support their children. And it's, you know, I know it sounds, you know, it takes a village, you know, but it does. It takes a lot of people. And all of these things are important as to how you create and how your child develops in the community. And that the community is it's okay to look out for each other.